Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. My name is Bri Bonomo. Hi if you're new here, or hey if you've been here before. Today we are going to be doing my October reading wrap up, and I had some wonderful, fun, and exciting books that I read in the month of October. Really a lot of books that just got me into the spooky season and really just revived my love of Halloween. So without further ado, let's just jump into those books. So the first book that I finished in the month of October was Horrid by Katrina Leno. I recently included this in a spooky reads book, and that was because I really enjoyed this. This follows a girl named Jane who, after the death of her father, he died unexpectedly. Her mother and her travel from California to a very small town in Maine where her mother grew up. But her mother grew up in this very lavish manor type of house, but there's always been a weird haunting history of the house. And the town all knows about it, and her mother knows about it, but Jane knows nothing about this past. So when she shows up to the house, weird things start to happen. And the book kind of takes a gothic vibe of determining whether or not it is supernatural, if it's just eerie, if it's coincidence, if there's something else to it. I gave this book 5 out of 5 stars. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I loved the fact that you were always kept on your toes and you didn't quite know if things were real or if they were happening or if it was a kind of grief struck induced hallucination, because Jane is grieving her father. So there's a lot that goes into this book, but it's a really quick and short read. So the fact that you're able to get all of these emotions and confusion in here in such a good book, in such a short book, was incredible. I highly recommend this one. I started my month off really strong, and I continued to go strong after this. The next book that I read in the month of October was The Initial Insult by Mindy McGinnis. The Initial Insult is currently not available. It is going to be out in February of 2021, but I was able to receive an ARC of the book, and I was so happy. It did not disappoint. The Initial Insult follows two main characters, Tress and Felicity. Tress's parents mysteriously disappeared one night, and she is convinced that her once best friend Felicity knows where and what happened to them, because Felicity was the last person to see her parents alive. So in this book, it flashes back and forth from present day when they're in their senior year and throughout their history of kind of building up how Tress and Felicity's friendship fizzled out. But during their senior year, Tress decides that she finally needs answers, because she's determined that Felicity knows something about the disappearance of her parents. And because of this, Tress is going to exact revenge by sealing Felicity in a basement wall that she's creating of a house that's about to be demolished. She's hoping that she'll be able to break Felicity before she actually has to carry out this event. But nothing is quite as it seems, and there's a lot more at stake and at play that are against both of these girls. This was such a fun and twisted thriller. Mindy McGinnis, as always, delivers, and she does not hold back by any means. I ended up giving this book a 5 out of 5 stars. She is one of my favorite authors, and I truly cringed, and I was horrified, and I felt so many emotions reading this book. I think the way that she writes is so in your face and direct, but in a way that really makes you step back and think through actions and your thoughts and your emotions. Mindy McGinnis definitely has a way of evoking a lot of things and taking real feelings that we would experience on a daily basis and throwing them into situations that are so extreme that it makes a compelling story. I highly recommend this. As I mentioned, it comes out in February of 2021, and you should be able to get it in pretty much, I think, all formats, ebook, hardcover, and audiobook by that time. The third book that I finished in the month of October was Wayward Witch by Zoraida Cordova. This was one of my most anticipated books of the year, and it wasn't my favorite book of the month. It unfortunately didn't go in a direction that I was quite anticipating, but I enjoyed it for what it was. So let's get into what this book is about. So this book is the third and final book of the Brooklyn Brujas series by Zoraida. This is a series that follows three sisters as they are in different points of their journey into coming into their witch powers. The first book is Labyrinth Loss, which follows Alex and Alex's journey as she tries to save her family from the underworld that she unknowingly sends them to. The second book is Brujaborn, who follows Lula, the third and oldest, or the oldest sister of the three, and it follows her journey as she tries to find a way to bring back her boyfriend from the dead and unknowingly sets an entire zombie army loose on the streets of New York. And then this book follows the third and youngest sister, Rose, as she recently deals with the return of her father, who she has not known for 7 years and disappeared when she was 3 or 4. So it's kind of her navigating what her relationship with her dad is, as well as the two of them getting sent into a fairy realm and trying to figure out how to return home. So pretty much I think that's the summary of this book. I don't think I have to really say more about it because that's pretty much the entire plot is Rose trying to figure out her relationship with her dad, stuck in a fairy world, and trying to find her way back home. This book, I ended up giving it a 3 out of 5 stars. It was good. I definitely think this whole book caters to the younger side of the YA genre, where I think if you are 12, 13, 14, 15, this series is fun and endearing and can be enjoyable. For this book in particular, though, I think I just felt very disconnected with the characters and with Rose and her father's relationship. I feel very callous saying this, but I didn't really care about it. I think it was because, unfortunately, there was a disconnect, because even though this was a big part of Rose's journey, is discovering what her dad means to her, her dad was very much absent from the majority of this book. And I just felt then, because of that, I didn't really care about redeeming himself and making points and all of that. And I just kind of found myself drifting and not really sticking with the story. I pretty much finished it because I really wanted to read this book and love it, and I wanted to maybe change my mind. But all in all, it was a fun story, but not my favorite of the year. I still think if you are a young adult, a true young adult, a young teenager, and like to read some fun-hearted stories, this entire series is perfect. Overall, I'd probably give the series a 3 out of 5 stars. It's a solid read. Nothing amazing, but nothing bad either. So that's kind of my thoughts on this book. The next book that I finished in the month of October is Burn Our Bodies Down by Rory Power. I also mentioned this in my spooky reading recommendation. This book follows a teenage girl who has pretty much never known anything about her family's history. She is living with her mom, and her mom never brings up her past and doesn't want Margot to know anything about anything that has to do with her family. So Margot just thinks that it's just her and her mom and she has no other family, until one day she finds a picture of a person and a phone number on the back of that picture stuck in her mother's old Bible, and realizes very quickly that it is her grandmother, who she didn't know existed. So she reaches out to her grandmother and makes a plot to return to this small town named Faylene, and realizes that there's a huge history in this town and her ancestors do not have the best of reputations in the town. So her grandmother owns a bunch of corn stalks and used to have a farm, but the farm isn't doing too well. And there are some creepy things that are happening and weird similarities, and as soon as Margot arrives, the entire town pretty much explodes with new chaos. So I gave this book a 4 out of 5 stars. I really liked the journey. I liked that there was another book of this month that was like that gothic vibe of, you know, is it supernatural? Is there a real life explanation? And it kind of kept you guessing throughout this entire book. I also like that there's some hints to queer representation, but there really isn't a love story in this, and I liked that it was more natural and just hinted at and not the plot, because I love queer stories, but I don't see a lot where it's just like, this is the character, but we're not focusing on that. And that was kind of refreshing to see. It was normal and I loved it. Overall, I think the only reason that I'm not really giving it a 5-star is because there was some predictability in it, and because there was some predictability, I felt that it just kind of at times fell into well done tropes, essentially. I would have liked to see maybe a different take or a fresher take on it, but again, it really didn't diminish my enjoyment of the story. It was just a little bit something that I would have read in other books down the road. So overall, I highly recommend this as well, and I would love to know if you guys read any of these books, past and the next ones I'm going to talk about. Let me know down in the comments and tell me what you think of them. The fifth book in the month of October that I read was Star Daughter by, and I'm gonna butcher it, but it's Shveta Thakrar. I don't think I did it right. I listened to the audiobook of this, and it was pronounced in the audiobook, and then my brain goes, what was that again? So here we are, and I'm so sorry. But this book follows our main character named Sheetal, who is living with her family, and she grows up with her father, and is very close to her cousin and her aunt and their family. And it's a very lush Indian culture, to my understanding. So essentially, Sheetal grows up without her mother because she is the daughter of a mortal father and a star mother. Her mom is a full star and goes back to the heavens when Sheetal is pretty young and doesn't really get a chance to see her mother until she accidentally uses her half-star magic and burns her father, which sends him into a coma, and Sheetal has to figure out a way to save him. So she decides to try to enter her mother's star kingdom, and in doing so realizes that her family is going to partake in a centuries-old tradition amongst the stars to have a champion and become the new ruler of their kingdom. Sheetal's family wants her to be their champion, and in exchange they will help save her father. And this story follows Sheetal as she goes on her journey to hopefully become the champion, give her family of her star kingdom their rightful titles, and save her father as well. This is the first book in a series, and it is definitely a fun ride. This is another book that I feel like will again appeal to some kids who are a little bit younger on the young adult spectrum, but has appeal for older adults and older teens as well. I think the environment and the world is just so lush. It is so refreshing to read another culture, and one that is very much focused in this book, and it was really great. I just felt very immersed, and the writing just, I pictured so much, and I pictured all of these different environments, and it was very poignant, and I loved it. I ended up giving this book a 4 out of 5 star. I think it was absolutely good for I think this is her debut novel, although I think she has short stories published before this. It's a great first novel as well as a great entry into a series. I'm not sure how many books the series is going to be, but it was a fun time. It kind of mixes a little bit of fantasy and sci-fi because we have that space stuff with the stars, and I really, really love the star lore. I'm not sure if the lore has anything to do with like her culture, the author's culture, but I loved it either way. So if it was based on real culture or mythology, or if she made the mythology, either way, I loved it. It was such a great read. So I definitely recommend reading this as well, because so far the entirety of this list that I've read this month, I've been able to recommend. And last but not least, I read Poems for the End of the World by Katie Wismer. Poems for the End of the World is a poetry collection, and it's Katie Wismer's second poetry collection. If you don't know who Katie Wismer is, she has a YouTube channel called Kate's Book Date, and she talks about books and her writing and her job, and she does kind of a little bit of everything anymore now that she graduated from college. So this is the second book that I've read from Katie. The first one was her novel, The Anti-Virginity Pack, which I read earlier this year, and now I read this one as well. And unfortunately, I was a little underwhelmed by the poetry book. I am not going to give this a rating just because I really think that I am not a fan of this contemporary style of poetry. And I heard another YouTuber reference this, such as like Rupi Kaur and Gabby Hanna's poetry. And I'm going to probably put Katie into this bracket of this like micro poetry where we have like some pretty short and choppy lines or very, very, very small poems. And it's just not my cup of tea personally. I'm not a fan. I like my poetry to, even if it's shorter poetry, I like it to be like an extended metaphor. I like each word, each sentence to have meaning, each break of the sentence to be significant or some way. And I didn't get that with the majority of these poems, unfortunately. I did like a few, and the ones that I liked typically were a little bit longer and seemed to have each sentence or every word that was mentioned seemed to be significant. And again, that's the type of poetry I like. But for the most part, a lot of these poems, to me, were not my favorite poetry because they seemed more like an Instagram caption, a tweet, a Tumblr post, things that I would see when I was 16 and really gravitated with because they were short and like felt me in my heart and soul. But as an adult and knowing now I've taken so many different courses of poetry and I love the classics, I just don't think contemporary poetry is my jam, and that's kind of sad. I do think that her cover art is absolutely gorgeous. And again, there were a few poems in her collection that I did resonate with. The other issue that I had, I think it was just because Katie, this book is very personal for her, and you can just tell that she expressed herself a lot in her poetry. Katie struggled with different things that I have never felt, specifically with prolonged illness or chronic illness. I do not have that, and I could, even though like I appreciated reading poetry about it, it was hard because I didn't know it, so I can't have any experience and input on that poetry. Similarly, with having a breakup and then going into the dating field again, I have not had like an adult breakup ever. And I haven't had a long relationship end. So it's hard for me again to put myself in that position just because I haven't been in it. So I'm not saying that that's a knock for her. I could tell that she pours her heart and soul into this and like these words mean something to her, but they didn't mean as much to me. And therefore I just kind of kept reading and I never actually sat and with one poem and felt it to my core. So that is on me, and that is why I'm not going to rate this book. It's just something that I didn't enjoy, but I think if you like this micro poetry, the contemporary style, then you probably would like this. It's definitely up that alley, like similar to, I think Rupi Kaur's is like this for the most part. But also, honestly, Gabby Hanna. I know Gabby Hanna's poetry gets blasted quite a bit, but it's a very similar style to what Katie does. So if you did like Gabby Hanna's poetry, you will probably like Katie's. And that's all I have to say. So that is it, my friends. Those are the 6 books that I read in the month of October. Overall, majority of these books were absolutely positive, and I just had so much fun reading them all. I'm really happy that I started to expand my reading taste, especially during this month, because my goal was to read more horror this year. And up until October, I really didn't read a lot of horror. But we did. We read 2 books that were horror in that genre, and one that was a thriller but could maybe be a little bit of horror, which is Mindy McGinnis's book, The Initial Insult. And as of my reading for November, it's probably going to slow down a bit because I'm going to be writing more, but I am in the middle of 2 horror books as well. One I chose to do on audiobook because I am going to be driving in the month of November for my job, and I figured I'm going to choose one long audiobook to read throughout the month, so hopefully that won't distract me from my writing too much. But otherwise, let me know down below what books you read in the month of October, what were your favorites, what were your least favorites, and are there any on this list that you are interested in or have read and you would, and if you want to, please share your thoughts down below. And until next time, I will see you then. Bye.